Welcome back. We're having a really interesting topic today, and I think, you know, already what we're learning is it's immense. I mean, so much. We've had a lot of inquiries during the break, and Jane from Delaware here says, what is, happens when you rely only on a partner for self-worth? I mean, where they, you know, she says her boyfriend has left her feeling like worthless because everything he told her, she's struggling to get into a new relationship. What's going on there?
Like, you mean he's struggling or she's struggling?
She's struggling because she says she relied on him for her self-worth.
Okay. Well, that's very interesting. Remember I mentioned to you that a lot of times happen to people. Sometimes we don't really believe that it could be happening to people in general, but it does. Well, Jane is the proof of that in this case. Well, Jane, all we can say for today is that, remember, happiness do not belong to him. Happiness belongs to you. Happiness belongs to everyone. And we need to get relief from any of our thoughts and our fears. And in this case, from what you are saying, you have a lot of fear to be on your own. And you are really giving all the good things, putting him into his hands and his heart. And if your boyfriend is gone for now, then let it be. And start just capturing your own happiness within yourself. Pull the best of yourself. I'm sure you have a lot of good things to offer to yourself to begin with. And then, you know, somewhere else, to somebody else as well. However, you must really be confident in who you are and what can you give to yourself. In general, you can also start doing, different tasks for you. Like, you can actually maybe start doing some activities that fulfill your heart, especially your mind, because if you fulfill your mind with good things in general, then a lot of sensations and good emotions are going to come after that to you. And that's when you are going to start feeling great. You know, many of the love stories, when they say they break up for any reason, and then him or her, the one that with a broken heart, after they start doing something else, something different, something to fulfill their profession, their home, their minds, everything, then they start being successful all the sudden.
Yeah.
Do you know the story with the writer for Harry Potter?
Oh, J.K. Rowling.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, that's exactly what happened to her.
That's right.
That's exactly what happened. She was broken heart. She was actually broken, you know, economically wise as well. And then she said, well, you know, I wipe my tears off. I cry. I suffer. And then, you know, she was in a coffee place every day writing the Harry Potter book. Did you know that?
So she just gave herself a project to lift herself up again, right?
And then when you fulfill your mind with a different situation, then your emotions start to give you confidence back again. And that's, Jane, that's exactly what you need. You got to be confident that you don't need not him, not anyone, nobody. All you need is you, your emotions, your passion to do something. Because if we feel passion for something, it doesn't matter what it is, we are going to do and create really wonderful things in our lives. And not only for us, but also for the people that are near us. People that actually we love. Our children, our friends, our family members, brothers, sisters, mother, father, employees.
Yeah, absolutely. That's going to spread off as virtue for everybody around you to see that you've picked up your self-image, you've picked yourself off the floor and you've got on again and you've said, you know what, this guy, you know, whoever you broke up with, you're better than him now. You know, don't let him define who you are or your relationship with him define the way you are for the rest of your life. Okay, say it's his loss, move on. And like you say, find a new activity, find a new you, and get a stronger self-image.
Yes. A lot of people, I would like to say, sometimes, I'm not saying that, Jane, this is your case, but sometimes people, in their childhood, they have some abandonment trauma. Children are too often helpless pinballs in a life game that tosses them from a relationship to relationship. usually unable to affect the outcome. These early experiences make them more likely to either distrust relationship partners or try too hard to overtrust them. Their insecure attachments to their caretakers in early life too often cause them to become overly fearful adults, unable to let love in for fear that inevitable loss will occur. Definitely. Now, another fact is relying, like you were saying, you know, only on a partner for self-worth, right?
Yeah.
And so we can actually, we cannot do that. The partner to allow the other to be entrusted as a sole definer of that person's basic value, it's like putting all one's eggs in the same basket. There is bound to be total devastation if that belief does not result in place. Like just like we were saying earlier.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, there's, after you've let go, or if you've been a child, like you talk about that abandonment sense, and it is difficult for children, I think, if they've experienced that ping pong effect, isn't it? You know,
yeah.
they've been bounced in and out of relationships. They therefore become either over trusting, trying to find trust, or they can't trust.
Or they
again,
can't trust.
One or the other.
And we cannot do that. So they can only find fault in who they've been, what they've done wrong, and they might always be unlovable to anyone else.
Yeah.
So, but also here it comes the fear of failure. It's another very typical personality in general. Fear of failure, I'm sure you have met before somebody on those situations.
Well, this could be a classic situation, like on the wedding day, and somebody just being jilted at the altar, right? You know, the classic, he didn't show up at the wedding and I was left there. I don't understand what happened.
Exactly.
And he's like, I didn't want to go through with it. I was terrified of what was coming down the road, right?
Well, there are people who are literally terrified of failing at anything, and relationship especially, are just one piece of the puzzle. They give their all to whatever they pursue and can't face that fear efforts might not bear out in something as important as love relationship. In their fear of failing, they too often either overreact when something seems to be going wrong or miss crucial clues because of their hyper-vigilant focus, right?
Mm-hmm.
When their partners leave the relationship, they often take all of the blame. Have you heard or seen some of those cases before? So feeling that they should have done more or even better. Often that self-denigration makes each succeeding partnership more susceptible to failing for the same reasons.
Well, that's a difficult one, isn't it? You know,
when
people load themselves up with blame and they don't, you know, they should really be saying the issues were, I wasn't the one who had that issue, it was him or her, and they're assuming the responsibility for the other one's actions.
When that happens, many of the times, Elliot, the person that, who has this situation, they have a very strong psychological damage.
Mm.
Sometimes it comes already, it's a path from themselves, but sometimes it's being caused by the partner that just left. Did you know that?
What happens when that partner leaves? I mean, there's obviously some rebuilding that needs to be done, but you're saying, you know, it can go on for years. You know, that person is just lost. They can't get themselves back. They can't get into another relationship, carrying all that burden of that guilt, which is not really theirs to carry, really.
In those cases, their self-esteem is really damaged. And basically, it's like not on the floor, it's beneath. It's underground. Underground, completely. Mm. And when that happens, of course, they need a lot of psychological help. And they need to go with a specialist on the matter, because otherwise, they will never be able to move on. It's very difficult for those type of people to do, because even if it wasn't their fault and they are blaming themselves for that,
yeah,
that means that they have zero love for themselves, zero respect for themselves as well. And also, there are another ones that kind of similar, the romantic fantasizers. That's another type of personality in relationships.
Yeah.
This one, tribe are not romantic in the storybook sense. So, they begin as all new relationships do with mutually seemingly, you know what I mean? Like they really accept each other at the beginning, yeah, right? Yeah. They love each other. They feel like, oh, this is, we are like all together for the rest of our lives. And they must eventually work out in the differences and challenges, of course, like any couple, any partners, that all long-term commitments create. Anyway, so those who are dedicated to holding on to romantic fantasy, however, represent a different breed. These partners want to be all things to their lovers, as if in a cloud of intensive and outgoing rapture. When the normal disruptions of life intervene, romantic fantasizers see them as only temporary obstacles and don't take them seriously. When a romantic fantasizer wants to hold on to bliss at any price, the other partner often feels unseen and unknown, and eventually, of course, will seek a more realistic encounter.
So what would, how would that show up? I'm trying to think of an example, or, you know, of a couple that, you know, one is so unrealistically, you know, with those rose-tinted glasses, and like you say, life comes along, something gets in the way, and something brings you crashing down to earth, and that fantasizer is still in a bubble.
Exactly.
And just doesn't take that seriously. So the other partner's like, come on, get real. I mean, this is real life and you're in a bubble. I mean, you know, that must,
In general, people tend to idealize things. What's the ideal of something according to their perception, their own perception? Let's say a woman and a man, right? Let's say that she is a person who does not believe so much in the family, let's say. And he is a very family believer or very family orientated. Let's speak of that example for a moment.
That's good.
Okay. Then when that happens, of course, what do you think is going to be his idealization? His ideal is to have the family together. Now, what do you think is going to be her idealization? Well, family is important, but it's not everything in life. Okay. Then when they want to create a family together, or they want to speak about things together as a family and as partners, then when that happens, then of course, each one of them will react in a different way. And the fantasizer, in this case, will be the guy, right? Because that, he needs to understand that she is not a very family-oriented person. So he cannot force her, he cannot force the relationship into you have to do this. Why? Because this is the ideal of the family. They must make agreements, but they must understand each other. She must understand that he is a very family oriented, and he must understand that she is not in this case. But in general, if you fantasize about that the other one will take your perception, and because you love that person so much, then it's going to happen out of magic, it's not going to happen. You know, so we have to open our eyes, and it's better to make agreements than just keep fantasizing on something that will never happen. It will not happen at all. So because people has tendencies in general, and patterns are patterns. They are going to repeat one after the other time, again and again and again.
So in a couple, I mean, one has to then point out to the other, listen, you know, before breaking off, there's got to come a dialogue of saying, why is it that you don't take these things seriously that are important to me, and you seem to be in a bubble? And, you know, there has to be at some stage a discussion about it, right? Before there's a breakup.
Exactly. And also trying to make agreements is very difficult for the reason you just explained, Elliot. That's exactly why. But we have a lot more for you. Stay with us at Sunday morning. We're very intense in this program. Okay. See you soon.